Hello, welcome to Free Bible Commentary with Pastor Teacher Dr. Bob Utley. Be sure to visit Free Bible Commentary at www.freebiblecommentary.org. Now, here's Bob.
Hello, we're coming to the conclusion of Mark. We're going to be in Mark 15, 40 through 47 today. There's such a discrepancy between the different gospel accounts of this last few days. Each one records a little different account of what happened. And that's caused many folks to doubt the Bible's veracity. But I really think what we have is eyewitness accounts. And we don't have mechanical forced unity. We have what different people remember. Just like today, if there was a wreck and you had two eyewitnesses, they would see it a little bit different. Well, that's what the Gospels are, eyewitness accounts. I want to show you a book that I think will be very helpful in this. This is called The Harmony of the Gospels by A.T. Robertson. The reason I like this so well, this book, very quickly, is going to show you the different Gospels. You see the page there? If I get my little card out of the way. It has Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. It'll show you the parallel passages. This is so helpful to know when what Mark says and how Luke records the same thing. And so this little book is very helpful. It's by Harper and Row. And I think it's going to be something to help you as you study the gospel, especially in this last week. Now, another book that I really like, I found it years ago. I'm afraid I've doodled on the front of mine. There's no red letters on this originally. It's called The Life and Teachings of Jesus Christ. It's by James Stewart, put out by Abingdon Press. And I like this little book so much. I guess the best description I have ever read on the temptations of Jesus comes from this little book. And it's a little paperback, and I think it'd be well worth your time and money to buy this on the life of Christ. Now, the best book that I have ever seen on the life of Christ is this book by Shepherd, The Christ of the Gospels. Now, I believe it's almost out of print. Let me see if I can get the title there. I called the bookstore the other day, and they had 11 copies left at the publisher. You can still find them in some bookstores in paperback. Now, this book, the reason I like it so much is because it is extensively indexed, just page after page after page, to help you bring the gospel accounts together. Now, let me tell you how to do it. If you notice on my books, I have a little red dot on them. What that means is that I have indexed this to a system I use. I don't know what system you use, but if you'll buy books like this and find your teaching Bible, and in the margin of your teaching Bible, put the notes by the verse, a red dot or a blue dot or something in your teaching Bible, then this will become a reference edition for you, and it will really be helpful. This is the best book on Christ I know. Now, here's a large book. It used to come out in two volumes. It usually was paperback. This is The Life and Times of Jesus the Messiah. Can't quite read that on there, can you? There you go. By Edersheim, Alfred Edersheim. He is a Jewish man that accepted Christ, and he looks at Christ through the eyes of a Jew. And I want to tell you, it's so helpful to me, and it is extensive, I want to tell you. It really has a lot of Judaism in it, first century customs. It has been invaluable to me in understanding Jesus as a Jewish man of his day. I'm going to deal with the other two a little bit later because there's some problems in this text that I think are really helped by a Bible encyclopedia. Now, verse 40. Now, several women were there looking on from a distance, among them Mary of Magdala, Mary the mother of the younger James and Joseph, and Salome. Now, I've got a graphic I want to show you that shows these women, the two Marys. And they're very hard to find out who is who here. Now, Mary of Magdala is, of course, the woman that Jesus cast out seven devils from. She has also followed him from Galilee. Many women followed the apostolic group. Apparently, they were wealthy women, widows or what, I don't know. But they followed. The other Mary there, you can see on the outline, there's some doubt about who her husband was. And there's some real confusion. And then Salome I'll talk about in a minute. I want to show you in, this is the Zondervan Pictorial Bible Encyclopedia. And this is the volume that starts out. This is the M volume. Notice it says, Mary, the mother of Jesus, Mary of Rome, mother of John Mark, Mary of Bethany, Mary, mother of James and Joseph, Mary of Magdalene, Mary, the gospel and the birth of, and on and on. These little sets are so helpful. If you're looking for something very rapidly to find out who these women are and how they relate and where they're found, this is the best source you can have. And you can get this thing for under $100. It's the best gift you could give someone you love or one of your children. It's a Bible encyclopedia. And this is the best one out, I think, the Zondervan Pictorial Bible Encyclopedia in 5 volumes. Now, all these Marys are really confusing to me. There's Mary in John 19:25. That's not related to these two Marys. Oftentimes, Mary Magdala is identified with a harlot, but that's not in the scriptures. It's just tradition. And there's so many Marys through here that a book like that Zondervan Encyclopedia really helps me get my act together. And here's another lady named Salome. Well, from Matthew 27:56, we realize she is the mother of James and John and the wife of Zebedee. Okay, so we're talking about James and John, the brothers. That's Salome's children. But Mary, the mother of James the younger, that's another James in the apostolic group. Okay, and there's some debate on who she married to. Alphaeus or Cephas, we're just not sure which she is, really. Now notice where it mentions, used to accompany him when he was in Galilee, besides several other women who had come up from Jerusalem with him. These ladies followed him. I don't know how large a group it was, but there are a large number of women that followed the apostles, and I think really ministered to them monetarily many times. And verse 42, although it was now evening, yet since it was the preparation day. Now, this has been a lot of discussion about what day this happened on. John and the synoptics seem to have different times. And I've talked to you in an earlier program. It seems that John uses Roman time and the synoptics use Jewish time. But John does use Jewish time some of the time. It's really difficult to know. Now, when it says night was evening, Jews usually ate their dinner between 3 o'clock and 6 o'clock. The only dinner they had after 6 o'clock was the Passover service. Now in Exodus 12:6 it has evenings plural. And that's where they get the idea. There was considered 2 evenings, 3 to 6 and after 6. And so the Passover was eaten after sundown. And that was the meal that seems to be referred to here. Now the preparation day, this was the day before the High Holy Sabbath. And that the High Holy Sabbath starts at 6 p.m. Friday night. So they were crucified, but usually it took them days to die. It is not uncommon for someone to live 3 or 4 days on the cross. You see, they kept giving them a little water every now and then, not out of any sense of mercy, but to prolong their agony. Remember, crucifixion was much the same philosophy behind our capital punishment. We hope that if someone sees someone electrocuted, that they're going to be a little more reticent in committing murder. Well, the Romans wanted this to be a prolonged agony, and so it took many days. And usually, as I said before, death was usually by asphyxiation. Now, because it was this preparation day before the High Sabbath, and you could not leave the bodies on the cross, the Romans broke the legs of the two thieves so they would bleed to death, and they could not push themselves up to breathe. So it's a combination of, I'm sure, bleeding and asphyxiation. But Jesus was already dead. Now look what it says. This is the day before the Sabbath. Joseph Arimathea, a highly honored member of the council. Now we learn a little bit about Joseph from John 12:42 and 19:38. Apparently it says he was a secret disciple of Jesus. Now, the reason is for, as in 12:42 it says that the Pharisees got together and said, anybody who says they're a believer in Jesus of Nazareth, we're going to kick them out of the synagogue. So it seems that Nicodemus and Joseph Arimathea believed in Christ but were undercover. And yet, they didn't stay that way. When everybody else was ashamed, everybody else had fled, these two men went public and said, Pilate, can we have the body? Now, that may not seem very radical to you, but this was an insurrectionist, a treasonous person, and they're going to the official Roman government saying, can we have his body? Can we bury him? Now, they had to be buried before 6 p.m. that day. They had to be off the cross and buried. And so we don't know exactly when Jesus died, but sometime between 3 and 6. Member of the Sanhedrin, of course, that's the ruling council of the Jews in Jerusalem, 70 members, and it's a very large group. Apparently, Joseph and Nicodemus were not present at this night trial. who was himself looking for the kingdom of God. Now, what do you think a Jew of the first century thought the kingdom of God was? Well, I'm sure that it had the concept, maybe back in Daniel, the Old Testament prophets. Jesus spoke on this theme of the kingdom of God so very often. His first sermon was about the kingdom of God. His last sermon, most of his parables, the kingdom of God is likened to. So it was a very important concept, and Joseph longed for that. Ventured to go to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Now remember, this is the preparation day for the Sabbath. Joseph is going to do two things that would make himself ceremonially unclean. He could not participate in the Passover service this year. Number one, he's going to go into a Gentile's house to ask Pilate for the body. That made him ceremonially unclean. Second, he's going to touch a dead body. That made him unclean for a period of time. And yet I think he's gone beyond ceremonial cleanliness now, and he recognizes something of who Jesus is. Pilate wondered whether he was dead yet. You see, Pilate, I guess, expected him to live a lot longer than that. And though he gave permission for the other two men's legs to be broke, he was surprised that Jesus died in something like 6 hours. Remember, he was crucified at 9. He's dead by 3. 6 hours is all that Jesus lived on the cross. He died very, very quickly. And calling upon the captain to him, asked whether he was already dead. But when he found out from the captain that he was, he gave permission to take the body. Now, the Greek word for body is the word soma, and it's used quite often by Paul and all the rest of the New Testament authors. But this particular word is toma, P-T-O-M-A, which means corpse. And so it's obvious in the choice of this word that Jesus is dead. Verse 46. So he brought a linen sheet and took him down from the cross and wrapped him in a linen sheet. Now let's talk about Jewish preparation for burial. The Jews did not practice any kind of embalming like they did in Egypt. Now, really, our society is much like Egypt. We try to we take the blood out of a corpse. We put embalming fluid in. We're trying to preserve that body for as many years as possible. Now, that's more like Egypt. That's not Jewish. Even today in Israel, they don't embalm people. They have to bury them within 24 hours. And so what we have here is the typical embalming rites as far as they went of the Jews. They would get long strips of linen, about that long, and they would wash the body, and they would wrap it in linen cloth and put spices, Aramaic spices, in between the linen wraps. And so they kind of wrap it up like a mummy with the feet together, or maybe the feet apart, it depends. And so apparently Joseph had planned this before, because the shops would have closed before he could have got them at 6 o'clock. So what he has, he bought this days ahead of time in preparation for what he had already made his mind up he was going to do. And so here we have them coming and getting the body and wrapping it in linen. You might want to see John 19:40 implies that he washed it first. What he washed it with, I don't know. I really don't know. There's not much time left now. And laid him in a tomb that had been hewn out of rock. Now, in Isaiah 53:9, it says that Jesus is going to be crucified with two thieves and going to be buried in a rich man's tomb. Oh, this is fulfillment of prophecy. How I believe the Bible is the authoritative, inspired, supernatural self-revelation of God. Here we have predicted in minute detail in Psalms 22 and Isaiah 53 the crucifixion and death of Jesus Christ. There's no way he could have worked this out on his own, but minute details were fulfilled the day he died. It is amazing to me how people can read the Bible and its predictive element and not be convinced of the supernatural nature of that message. Hallelujah. We've got a book that comes from God. I know it has some things in it we can understand. We wonder why they said it this way and that way. But the message of the book is proved over and over by evidence that this is a supernatural book. I've done a tape on this called The Bible, Can I Trust It? Where I deal with archaeology, history, prophecy, unity of message, eyewitness accounts, all the things that are evidence for a supernatural Bible. I'd love to send you that tape if you'll just write for our free catalog. I think it'll be a great help to you. Now, that's what it says, and they roll the boulder up to the doorway of the tomb. Now, this is the word lithos. You've seen a grinding mill, that large round wheel with the hole in the middle. Now, this is a hewn rock, I believe, and the word boulder really doesn't describe what this is saying. It's not just a large rock. What we have here is a round rock that had been shaved on both sides, and it was pushed into a trench where it rolled down across the door of the tomb. Now, the reason this is so significant is the graves of these rich people were robbed over and over and over again. And so I think it must have taken not one man or two men or even three or four men. I think it must have taken a large group of men to roll one of these rocks away from this tomb. Now, the tomb was built into the side of a hill or a rock, and the door was closed by this large rock rolling down the front. So this was a very rich man's tomb. We found many of them in modern Palestine. I don't know whether Gardens Calvary is really the place where Jesus was crucified, and I'm not sure the Garden Tomb is really the place that Jesus was entombed. But they're much like what it must have been like, okay? Now notice, if you will, where it mentions then, and Mary Magdala and Mary, Joseph's mother, were looking on to see where he was put. And again, we have these women listed. The disciples have fled. Only these few women, now Mary, Jesus' mother, has probably already gone by this time home to be with John. Probably John has gone but came back. Every other disciple besides John has left. These few women hung in there. They wanted to see where Jesus was put. Why? Well, I really believe that these women knew that all of the Jewish funeral rites had not been observed. Maybe they had talked to Nicodemus and Joseph, I don't know. But what was missing was the little candles, very sweet-smelling candles, that were put in the grave or outside the grave to help the odor. And apparently these women wanted to see where he was laid so they could purchase these candles. As soon as the Sabbath was over, they purchased the candles. But it was already dark, or after 6 o'clock on Saturday, so they had to wait till Sunday morning early, the first work day. And they ran to the tomb to place these candles there. And of course, in chapter 16, we have the marvelous experience of how they saw the angels and the stone was rolled away and all that happened. You know, these accounts are such wonderful accounts. We see so clearly the historicity of the life of Jesus. Friends, we have more eyewitness evidence to the life of Jesus than we have of any ancient personage. And I believe we can trust the accounts. They are a little different here and there, but that's from eyewitness remembrances. Mark, of course, is the recollection of who? The Apostle Peter. And that's why there's so many Latin words in the Gospel of Mark. It's Peter's recollection written specifically toward Romans or Gentiles. You see, Matthew is written toward Jews, and of course he says things a little different. Quotes a lot more Old Testament passages for Jews. Luke seems to be written for a Gentile audience, Greek-speaking people. And so because each one of the Gospels has their own purpose, their own audience, and their own remembrances, they are a little different. The sequence of events a little different. What the title of his crime is a little different. Who saw him when is a little different. But I tell you, to me, that speaks of the genuineness of this book, not of any kind of false unity. I hope these books are going to be helpful to you. From time to time, I try to bring the best reference books that I know of. My library has so many books on Jesus that I think are just not very good. But these are the best that I know of, and they will help you in your study of the life of Jesus if you'll buy these three or four books. The one by James Stewart, The Life and Teachings of Jesus Christ, the one by Shepherd, The Life of Christ, and the one by Edersheim, The Life and Times of Jesus the Messiah, will really be helpful to you. I've enjoyed so being with you, and I'll see you again same time, same place next week.